for whom we are extremely appreciative and thankful for providing the venue for this, and also for providing a lot of the refreshments that you see in here. Let's give them an applause.
against the ongoing Holocaust. And so we wound up inviting one person. That person came, gave a presentation that was pretty lackluster, Alex and I thought. And so although we have a third editor in our volume, he wanted to go ahead and publish this. We said, well, if we're going to publish this, then we're going to have to do some work. Because we think there are problems here that really aren't being properly exposed. And so that was when the two of us started after the conference, working on this particular topic, and looking at really all kinds of strategies. These were things, to be authentic, we didn't look at things that were just not thought of or not contemplated during World War II. We looked at things that were actually done during the war, but in other contexts and for other purposes. And we asked ourselves the question, these same techniques, devices, strategies be applied to saving Jews when the ongoing Holocaust became known. And so that's the way we developed it, and that was our thinking. And here are some of the thoughts that we have. So, okay, first of all, here's a quotation from Søren Kierkegaard, Danish philosopher. Life can only be understood backwards, but it must be lived forwards. And what he is saying here is, look, to understand where we come from, we have to look backwards. And we have to look at history. And so Alex and I have certainly looked at a lot of historical sources for this. And tons of work, of course, has been done, both the Holocaust and World War II. But at the same time, we have to keep in mind that life has to be lived forwards. So what we can learn about it, we can try to apply lessons to what we're doing today, but before we make judgments, and before we particularly make moral and ethical judgments, and this is a topic that's full of moral and ethical question of priority. And I use that that term a little bit advisedly. But the question is, what if the Allies had accorded an ongoing Holocaust a vitally important priority in wartime planning and operations? The short answer is, by the way, they didn't. They didn't accord it any priority at all in wartime planning and operations. They simply did nothing, or next to nothing. Anything you see that you hear that the Allies did to aid the Jews in World War II was largely incidental. In other words, they did it for another purpose, and it happened to help the Jews at the same time. But very little strategy directed at this problem, and very little planning done about it. So the question is, we have to ask right away, what priority should this have? Because when we start getting into the arguments about what they did and what they didn't do, we're always going to be confronted with, oh, we had higher priority, we had other things that needed to be done. Second is the question of refuge. What if the Allies had made serious efforts to obtain places for European Jews seeking refuge from Hitler and the Nazis? The short answer to this one again is they didn't. And the question is, what could have been accomplished if they'd done that? And then finally, an action item, what if the Allies had either engaged in or supported non-military or military action directed against the so-called death camps in Poland, the six camps where Jews were taken to be exterminated? So these are the things we're going to explore. I'm going to summarize a few conclusions on the first one. I can't really go into it in detail. I'll give you an overview of the second, and we'll discuss the third, both of us, in greater detail. There's not a lot of dispute about facts on the ground when we're talking about weighting priorities. There is tons of evidence that has been sifted for decades in diplomatic cables, communications, memoirs, diaries, court records, classified documents that are now unclassified about what happened and when it happened. So we know most of that. What is left are questions regarding the nature and quality of the decision makers, those at the top of the Allied leadership. This is often characterized as a priority question. We don't think it is a priority question because our belief is that aiding the Jews while the Holocaust was going on is the most important priority we had during the war. And I can explain to you, and I put you all to sleep in about 5 minutes, how we can derive that through modern philosophy. I can talk about Immanuel Kant, I can talk about Wittgenstein, I can talk about all kinds of philosophers, but the bottom line is nobody tolerates, no philosopher, whether they're relativists morally or whether they're absolutists, no philosopher tolerates genocide. That is the intentional wiping out of a people to get rid of them, exterminate them, and wipe them off the face of the earth. That is not tolerated under anybody's system, and the idea that someone would do that makes it a high priority to stop if one can possibly do so while it's going on. And the other way I can measure this is look at it from a bit of hindsight, is what happened after the war. Well, after the war, immediately, we have war crimes trials that take place in Nuremberg, and I see some of you in the audience were at the radio play that was put on by the Mugabe Center last week, dealing with judgment at Nuremberg. And that was one example. There were two levels of trials at Nuremberg, but there were trials other places too. The Germans held some trials, the Poles held some trials. These trials were designed to put Nazi leadership personnel on trial, and these trials did indeed take place. And what was the evaluation of those trials? The Nazis stood up and said, "Well, look, we're a sovereign nation. We're just doing, you know, what we're trying to do." Well, of course, the first answer to that is you're waging an aggressive war, and you're not entitled to do that against other countries. But even within your own country, you're not entitled to do what you did because that is a crime against humanity, we said. We prosecuted people and we hung people because they engaged in this kind of thing. Otto Feichmann was taken to Israel, and he was put on trial in the 1960s. Crime against humanity is what when they were doing what they were doing, that it was intolerable, horrific, and something that was a crime against humanity, and therefore we were willing to execute them for it. And the question then becomes, if that was the case, and certainly that's a fact, then what about taking some action while these things were going on, instead of simply looking from hindsight and saying, let's see who we can drag into the dock and punish. Now, it's also interesting with regard to weighing this kind of priority that there's a great deal of, I guess, what I'm going to call fake news out there, coining the phrase that we often hear these days. It's all fake news. Well, here's a piece of fake news. And if there's one thing you get out of what you hear today, I'm hoping this will be it. This is what many of us were taught about the Holocaust. The Allies did not know about the unfolding Holocaust. They were shocked to first discover it when they liberated the camps in late 1944 and 1945. And of course, what did this mean? The camps we're talking about are the camps in Germany. The Allies didn't get to Poland. They didn't get to where six death camps were. But they got to places like Bergen-Belsen, like Buchenwald. And these places were places where medical experiments were carried out. These places were places where prisoners were starved to death. These places were places of brutal treatment. And certainly, yeah, the Allies got there. President, not president at that time, but general at that time, later President Eisenhower, led troops into Bergen-Belsen. When he got there, he was percipient enough to say, oh my gosh, what a little boy. We better make some record of this. And he keep very careful photography, and all the horrible photographs we see are largely from Bergen-Belsen, some from Buchenwald. But those places, yes, they were discovered, they were uncovered at that particular point. But what did the Allies know before that? Did the Allies get, did this come as a complete surprise? Did this wipe the smiles off everybody's faces about this issue? Oh, by no means, by no means. And why do I say this is false and absolute nonsense? Am I just exaggerating? You know, no, I'm not doing a Trumpish routine here, because I'm going to show you why this is absolutely false. The Allied Declaration of December 17, 1942. December 7th, 1941 was a day that lives in infamy, but this is a day that lives in twice as much infamy. Because on December 17, 1942, the Allies, and I say particularly, but it wasn't just the United Kingdom, the United States, and the USSR. They are, of course, the principal allies involved militarily in the war in a major way. But all of the Allies signed this declaration, every single one of them, which includes all the countries that had been occupied by the Nazis. They had governments in exile in London, and those governments signed onto this declaration. And this declaration spelled out what was happening to the Jews under Hitler. It started out with what? The Allies unanimously declared that the Nazis are now carrying into effect Hitler's oft-repeated intention to exterminate the Jewish people of Europe. That was in writing, signed by all the Allies. There is extermination going on. And how is the extermination going on? Well, let's spell it out. There was transportation, says the declaration, of Jews to Eastern Europe in appalling conditions, and their extermination in the principal slaughterhouse of Poland. The camps, the six death camps. They are worked to death, starved to death, or deliberately massacred in mass executions. They are never heard from. That's it. That's what the Allies said was happening. And so this raises a number of interesting questions, because there are a lot of scholars, there are a lot of historians that like to say, well, you know, concentration camps, that really wasn't massacre. That really wasn't annihilation. The reality was the Nazis had one plan from the beginning. You can read it in Mein Kampf. If you want to study the speeches of Hitler, it's all over the place. We need to rid ourselves of deaf cams. They were just deaf cams at different rates for different purposes, and they were designed, some of them, to exploit Jews before they wiped out. So that's a distinction that historians make that Alex didn't know. So these are questions of opportunity. So then, what resulted from all this? After the Allies get through declaring that this stuff is true and that it's happening, they say, condemnation. The Allied powers condemn, in the strongest possible terms, this bestial policy of cold-blooded extermination. It couldn't be described more eloquently than that. The principal authors were in the British Foreign Office. They did a great job. They spelled it out. This is exactly what was happening, and it lays it out pretty well. So then, what's the conclusion? The promised retribution. To ensure that those responsible for these crimes shall not escape retribution and press on with the necessary practical measures to this end. The promise made that we will bring these people to justice that are doing these horrible things to the Jews in Eastern Europe. Now, okay, that's the declaration. And this is something, as I say, every Allied power signed this. They all knew exactly what was happening at the end of 1942. So don't let anybody tell you it was 1944 or 1945. It was liberation. No, it had nothing to do with it. We knew exactly what was going on. Yes, we gained more and more detail because we had escaping prisoners come and tell us stories about what was happening in the camps. We had eyewitnesses come and tell us things. But the information was piled this high by the end of 1942. And as a matter of fact, if you want to be more precise on the date, we have a brilliant young scholar named Michael Fleming who wrote a book about Auschwitz in 2014. And he's written a chapter in our book as well. And Michael will take it back to the middle of 1942 or even earlier. The Wannsee Conference, which some of you know something about, was January of 1942. This is when one of my favorite Germans, Reinhard Heydrich, got a whole group together. He was appointed by Hitler personally to take care of things here. So he got a whole mass, got cabinet officials, civilian leadership, military leadership. Everybody had got one room in a beautiful place in a suburb, a home, in a private suburb in a suburb of Berlin. And he got them all together and he said, okay, now this is how this is going to work. And so he and his lieutenant, Adolf Eichmann, was there with him. And kept the books and kept the notes, and he made the set of minutes. There was a set of minutes in this conference. And they just went through and they said, okay, we're going to do this. We're going to ship to these camps and this and then we're going to, and we've got various methods. We're going to use carbon monoxide some places. We're going to use Zyklon B in other places. Drop the gas in and wipe them out. And then we got ways in which we're going to determine how we're going to burn the bodies and take care of the ashes. Very matter of fact, very laid out in terms of how all this was going to go. And he got some dissent. And I didn't think, my goodness, is a little war striking here and a little war at the Nazis? No. I wasn't what the dissent was about. People would stand up and say, no, I need my Jews. I need my Jews. They're doing valuable war work, and if you want me to get the quota out, I've got to have my Jews. And Heydrich's response to this was to point them to the phone and say, would you like to come up and make a call to the made estimates of the number of Nazis that were involved in the administration of the camps and the leadership at the senior level. And the calculations that have been done by a bunch of different scholars show that we prosecuted, just prosecuted, about 10% of the total that were involved. And, of course, convicted, executed, fewer. Now we're going from below 10% down to 7 and 5%, few percent, more at Auschwitz than anywhere else. Auschwitz was the show camp, you know, for the prosecution of the various guys. But the reality is, you know, these people got out of jail once they got prison sentences. I had a client when I worked in the Bay Area was a war crimes defense attorney. And he did this work in Germany for a short time, and then he also went over to Japan and did it over in Japan. And he explained to me, he was a very capable lawyer. At that time, he was involved in real estate development, which is why I was his lawyer. But he had a law degree from Brooklyn, grew up in New York, and he was Jewish. And he explained to me, he said, you know, when you were assigned to defend these cases, and we only had one strategy. Strategy, we never argued that these guys were not guilty. We never adopted the Nazi defense of, you know, I just follow orders, so you should find me not guilty. We said, no. The only thing we're trying to do is avoid the death penalty. Because if we can avoid the death penalty, if we can make sure that our client doesn't get hung at the end of this trial, they're going to get out. And they're going to get out quickly. That was their prediction. Now, who told the truth? The Allies tell the truth on December 17th, 1942? Or did this predicting lawyer indicate the truth? Much more the latter. What happened was, even when the guys, once they got prison sentences, they were all out of jail by the late 1950s. All out. Why? Why were they all out? Because we got tired of it. Got tired of doing this, plus strategic reasons for pacifying Japan, getting Japan back on the road, also for using Germany as a bulwark against communism and the coming Cold War. Those things became more important, and so crimes forgiven. All necessary practical measures not done. Now, so what happens? This declaration was read by Foreign Secretary Anthony Eden in the House of Commons on December 17, 1942. He read the whole thing to the members. They stood for a moment of silence, just as we did a few minutes ago. And so what happens? A question was posed to him by a member of Parliament. After he read the declaration, he was asked whether he was consulting with the other allies as to what constructive measures of relief are immediately practicable. Someone named Silverman, guess what he was, decided to ask the critical question. This is ongoing. This isn't like you describe something horrible, and now we're going to do something about it. It's going on every day as we're sitting here. So what is practically available here? Eden's response. We shall do all we can, I love those words, all we can to alleviate these horrors, though I fear that what we can do at this stage must inevitably be right. Note how this changes the whole playing field. The promise is we will do all we can. It makes feasibility the only real issue after December 1942. There's no question we know what is happening. The only question is, what can we do that's effective? What can we do that's helpful? What can we do that is a practical mission? And what is all we can? And that's what we're going to talk about today. Churchill has some views about this. Now, this is something Churchill said in July of 1944. There is no doubt this, and he means the Holocaust, is the most horrible crime ever committed in the whole history of the world. It is quite clear that all concerned in this crime who may fall into our hands, including the people who only obey orders by carrying out the butcheries, should be put to death. As I indicated a moment ago, promise not fulfilled. Despite the strength of this, by the way, Prime Minister Churchill wrote a six-volume history of World War II, and it's very exciting reading. He won a Nobel Prize for this work. Six volumes about World War II. Chapter on the Holocaust, on the most horrible crime ever committed in the history of the world. Not a chapter, not a sentence, nothing in that volume. Didn't think it was important enough to mention in the history of World War II. Okay, so the Holocaust in the balance. This is what the balance looks like. At the end of the day, the balance is very heavily on the side of all we can. Let's see what we can do, and whatever it is, we're going to do it. Because if we can do it, we need to do it. Because this is morally important, and there's nothing more wrong. Okay, feasibility. Let's talk about non-military action first. So what are we talking about? First of all, refuge in Palestine and elsewhere. This is a subject that Ed Raymond and I are going to talk about in a chapter of the book. And some of you heard a presentation I made a while ago on this. This is the white paper of 1939. You know, the British, at the threshold of the war, he wants to do all he can. But one of the things he absolutely refused to do in this 1939 white paper is, after some 17 years of allowing Jews to immigrate into Palestine, freely up to the economic absorptive capacity of the country. In other words, we'll take as many Jews as we can absorb, we can get jobs to, and we can support economically. We'll take them. They'll come. And by the way, why did Britain do that? Was it out of the goodness of his heart? No, it had nothing to do with that. They were obligated to do it by the British Mandate for Palestine, which was an international treaty issued by the League of Nations. Under Article 6 of that treaty, they were obligated to take Jews. Was the object. And why was that? Was that because we all love Jews? By no means, by no means. There was some sympathy in the winning Allied powers of World War I as to Jews, and they didn't want to provide a place for them. But Britain was interested in running Palestine, controlling Palestine, for no money. No money in. They wanted to break even, in other words, government in Palestine. They didn't want to put any money in, that's for sure. The League of Nations didn't have any money to put in, that was for sure. So let's run a break even. And how do we run a break even? Well, there's two ways to do it. You got to get labor from someplace to do work, and you have to get money, you have to get capital, you have to get people who invest in something that is initially, folks, I'm sorry, it's going to be a charitable enterprise for a while, because the Ottoman Empire did not leave Palestine in good economic shape. It was a horrible economic change, as a matter of fact. And so there had to be an economic restart there. And so it was money from New York Jews, and it was labor from Polish Jews. And I'm only slightly exaggerating on both of those fronts, because that's largely where the money came from, and that's largely where the labor came from. Into Palestine, that we're going to do that development project. Did it work? Has anyone been there lately? Obviously, it worked fabulously. It did an amazing job. Unfortunately, in the process of all this, it left the Palestinians behind. And therein lies the problem. This is how it all came about. But Britain did not want to invest money. So they were running a development thing there. For 17 years they did that. And then in 1939, they pulled the plug. They said, whoops, I'm sorry, the Arabs revolt now, and we have to spend money for that. Even though, by the way, they always broke even. They always the money whatever they got, tax-wise. But it said, no, we can't do this. We got a war coming. We got to pacify the Arabs. We have to appease the Arabs. So how are we going to do this? The 1939 white paper said, we're going to put a quota on Jews in for 5 years, and then we're going to stop them altogether, unless the Arabs consent. Well, of course, the Arabs are going to consent, right? Arabs are without any economic problems. There was war industry in Palestine that could have supported those Jews. And this was not done, and Britain refuses, and it continued to refuse even after the Nazis were kicked out of North Africa in 1943. So no more Nazi threat to Palestine during the war. They still, same policy, we are not permitting Jews in here. Absolutely not. We're going to take a staunch position on that. They threw them into internment camps. They sent them to places like Mauritius where they were devastated by disease. All this kind of stuff happened. But Palestine was just unavailable, despite the fact that was what it was for. Other places, the NIMBY factor. Anybody know what the NIMBY factor is?
Yeah.
Not in my backyard. We don't want Jews. We don't want Jews. Okay. All right, fine. I get it. Everybody was complaining, you know, coming out of the we're talking about the Depression at this point. So everybody, it was the worldwide Depression. So, okay, we have reasons we don't want more people generally. And, you know, of course, anti-Semitism explains why we don't want Jews in particular. But, I mean, so we got that. I get that. But the problem is, so you're in the position now of the major allied powers. The major allied powers who've got the military might, but who also have the money. To do something about this, and to encourage places to take Jews. Now, they themselves, of course, don't want Jews. We had, of course, strict quotas on immigration, not by religion. We had quotas or by ethnicity. We had quotas set up on area, and we didn't even fill those quotas because we were too busy trying to get Jews out. A lot of discretion, a lot of anti-Semitism in our State Department to keep Jews out. But the bottom line is, what are we going to do about this? We had international conference. The United States was great at putting on an international conference. If you ever want to go to an international conference, by all means, get a sponsor from the United States. Because the first one that they had was in 1938 in a place called Avion-les-Bains. Oh, sounds beautiful. And it is beautiful. Absolutely beautiful resort in the French Alps. And so you go there, and you know, you got a really fancy hotel, and you got all the skiing you want, you get the hot springs, and the whole bit. And so and they entertain you well. The United States entertained well. And the same thing was true in Bermuda, April of 1943. Who's been to Bermuda? Anybody been? Okay, all kinds of people go to Bermuda. Beautiful place, absolutely beautiful place. You know, a lot of Brits walking around in white shorts. You know, they're really cute. You know, they run the whole place there. It's a tax haven. It's really, really kind of a neat place to go. They hosted a conference there. Brought nations from all over into these conferences. But they sat at the head of the table and they said, okay, we're not going to change our immigration laws. Nobody's going to have to do that. Nobody has to change their immigration laws. And we'd just like to know, who's willing to take some Jews? And by the way, we are at the head of the table. We're not going to take any. And we're not offering any money. We're not offering any support. We're not offering any benefits. We just want to know what you'd like to do. Both miserable failures. Nothing offered, nothing gained. That's the motto. And I'll tell you, I have been in lawsuits. One of the joys of my law practice. I once in a while get to sue a lot of insurance companies. And one of the things that happens is insurance companies, you know, when they see a disaster and they're sitting around the table and there are a bunch of them that are liable, you know, they've issued policies on this disaster, they're all paralyzed. It's like the deer in the headlights, you know, they gotta run the other way because nobody wants to take that step forward. Well, one of the things that gets done to try to break broad jams like this, is they get good mediators who will gather these people in a room and then separate them out, pit them against each other, you know, get somebody to make offers, get some money out of the table, to get somebody else, and then once that they'll work on that one, beat them up until they put in their, and then they'll grab another one and say, all right, now look at what this guy did, now you better get in there. And eventually, the good ones will get cases settled that way because they'll get enough money around the table to equal what you need to get it settled. But you know, sometimes, and I had a group that did this to me once. They said, well, gee, you know, this was a sex molest case, by the way, against the Roman Catholic Church, and the The demand by the plaintiff's lawyers was $3.5 million. Two boys that had been very badly molested by the police over prosecutors and stuff. And so they need to sell, they need $3.5 million. And so where's the $3.5 million going to come from? Well, some of these insurance companies were willing to offer something. But a couple of them, you know, one of them said, well, my policy is only $1 million. And I can't do it. I can't settle a case with a million dollars. And another one said, well, mine's only $500,000, so I can't do it. But you start going around the table and adding things up, it's more than enough. And so the bottom line is none of them would do anything because individually they couldn't solve the problem by themselves. And so I finally gave up. We sued them all. And guess what? They tried that argument. In court, believe it or not, they tried that argument. I upset them and said, well, I didn't have a duty to do anything because I couldn't do it with a half a million. It was 3.5, and I couldn't do it with a half a million. And then I said to the court, I said, Judge, you can't let these people get away with it. Well, guess what? There's a published opinion of the California Court of Appeal now that declares that the law in the state of California, you put your money on the table in a situation like this. You don't just hang back and wait for somebody else to do it. Well, is this what happens? Sure, this is what happened. But we wouldn't do it. So it didn't happen. So what are we talking about? Second possibility. This is really cheap, guys. You don't have to offer money. You don't have to hold fancy conferences at Avion or Rubita. You just have to scream. Publicity and warning. You send publicity through all of the avenues that you have into Europe. We had all kinds of, you know, publications in local languages like Polish, we could broadcast to Poles, we could broadcast to Czechs, we could do all these things. Tell them what's going on in their own countries. Tell them, you know, that camp, by the way, that's down the road from you, about 6 miles. You know what's going on there? You know the trains that are coming in there? They're bringing Jews in there, and they're never heard from again. I mean, you know, tell these people what's going on. Make them collaborators. And also, issue warnings. Those who are collaborators are going to get it at the end of this war. Do things like that. And those things, ladies and gentlemen, they work. Once the Nazi threat is beginning to be pulled off of a population, now you have to have that happen. If there's a Nazi standing there with a gun to your head, you're going to collaborate. You're going to be an accomplice. You're going to do what you need to do to stay alive. But that began throughout 1943. And getting into 1944, all of a sudden that wasn't happening anymore. Because those Nazis, if those of you remember the kind of half-funny program, Alex and I joke about this, Hogan's Heroes. This is a satire supposedly on the Nazis of World War II. One of the things they used to say to Hogan's Heroes, and it was a very accurate reflection, that Sergeant Schultz was always worried in the camp there that if he didn't do his job right, the commandant didn't like him, he was going to go, and this is the way he put it, zoop, to the Russian front, you know, away he went. Well, that's exactly what happened. They had to commit their troops over there, because after the Battle of Stalingrad, and then the Battle of Kursk, this stuff is 1943, and by the middle of 1943, the Russians had knocked the stuffing out of the Nazis on the Eastern Front, and they were pushing in already. And so what does that mean? You have everything available getting out there. You're running your camps with more and more reserve from Ukraine and other wonderful people that love to beat up on Jews. So you had those people, and fewer and fewer of the SS, fewer and fewer that they were all off in their own divisions trying to do something on the Eastern Front. And so all of that was going on, which means the pressure was letting up. And if you were running trains, for example, in Budapest, deporting Jews to Auschwitz, you would just say, excuse me, I'm not gonna put the Jews on that train. And you look behind you, and there's nobody shooting you. And you could have gotten away with it. If you would have been reminded, the Allies are headed here, and when they get here, they're gonna question you. We didn't bother to do this. There was no strategy to do it. As a matter of fact, Michael Fleming talks in his part of our book that there was a strategy not to do it. The strategy was we don't want to tell people about what's happening to Jews because that creates kind of a sense. fireside chats that Roosevelt used to do during the war, you won't find one word about the ongoing Holocaust and retribution or anything about it in any of those ways. So, okay. Now, feasibility of military action. There's a couple of aspects of military action. There's one that's totally neglected. And I can't even believe this is totally neglected, but it has been. Never even considered. The Polish Home Army desperately needed material support and arms and could have been enlisted to destroy or cripple camp facilities. They were an extremely valuable source of information. The things they did during the war included disrupting Nazi supply lines, providing military intelligence, targeted assassinations. The Czech underground also did the assassination of Reinhard Heydrich, our good friend from before. He got hit, the Polish Home Army saved more Jewish lives than any similar organization. It had 200,000 members in 1943. It had 500,000 members by 1944, working underground in and around these various places in Poland. They could have been enlisted, and they tried. They tried. They constantly tried the Allies to get support. They told the Allies what was going on, and they got nothing. They got nothing. Very little. Very little. I can't say they got nothing because they did get some general support. But they could have done lots of things with sabotage. Sabotage would have been very effective in these camps. If you think about the defense of the camp. The defense of the camp is pointed inwards. They're concerned with keeping the prisoners in. They're not concerned with anybody attacking them because they're sitting in the middle of Poland. They feel invulnerable. So they're not worried about being attacked. They're to the extent they're worried about air attack, it's because they're in a military strategic area. And yeah, they'll have some anti-aircraft guns and things like that. They don't have anything, any heavy weaponry that's really designed to be pointed out. It doesn't take much of a machine gun, by the way, to stop a bunch of unarmed prisoners. So, but that's the way the defenses were set up. So these were prime targets for sabotage. Prime targets where you could move in, you could support people in the camp, you could set charges, blow things up, and do all kinds of things. But this was just not done. So now, what are we talking about with respect to possible military operations? You could have used the Home Army. You didn't do it. You could have used the underground. You didn't do it. So what about railways? And there were two things that were proposed, and I'm going to focus just on Auschwitz because I could talk to you about the other camps too. But Auschwitz is a good example because this happened in 1944, and there was pressure actually brought by Jewish groups against the governments, the United States and Britain. Please do something about the Hungarian Jews. There were at this point between 400,000 and 500,000 Hungarian Jews left in Budapest. And they're being rounded up by the Alt-Right government now in Budapest and being prepared to send to Auschwitz. So how do we, what do we want? Bomber rail lines that lead from Budapest and Hungarian areas in the north to Auschwitz. That's strategy one. Strategy number two, hit the camp itself. Hit Auschwitz-Birkenau, which was the death camp at Auschwitz that had all of the gas chambers. These proposals were made. So, what does the military say? Well, you know, bombing railways does no good. This was a classic thing right out of the book, right out of the military book. Look it up. Bombing railways. Don't bomb railways. They're too easy to repair. You don't get to bomb a railway. If you bomb a railway, they just fix it. They just go out there with a crew. And you know, all right, so you made a hole here, you made a hole there. But they bring in the track and they bring in a few new ties. And away we go. 24 hours, 48 hours later, we're all back on the rise. And I don't dispute it. It's true. Absolutely true. But that isn't the way you hit railways. What you do is you hit bridges and hubs. Bridges, because they're more difficult to repair. It takes you longer. It takes you much more material. And maybe because we're getting through the other word, you don't have it. And so that's a successful strategy. Hubs. Very successful strategy. The European railway system runs off of hubs. So let's look at hubs. Here are all the train lines, the major train lines, running to Auschwitz. across Germany and into Auschwitz here. And then they're coming up from Vienna and from Budapest here into Auschwitz. And then there are a whole bunch coming over here from Ukraine. This is also this particular area of the Soviet Union. All of these stops are moving in here. So you've got all of this. And of course, you realize that the Nazis were pushed out over here in 1940, initially 1941 and 1942. They were even pushed back later, but they were out there. And so, but again, where else? You've got, look, these train lines are coming from Athens, Greece. They're coming from Italy in here, Yugoslavia. I mean, so you can suck up the Jews from anywhere along these lines. They're really, really, but they're running off of the yellow dots are the main hubs. And what happens in the main hubs is you have lots of tracks coming together in the same place. You have lots of trains that are used to repair, replace. You know, this is the center of operations. Those you get. And how do we know that? How do we know that? Is this just Tony Tanky talking about what Tony Tanky thinks of us? No. This is Dwight Eisenhower talking about what Dwight Eisenhower thought should be done. It's called the transportation plan. It's what Eisenhower set up when we set up the D-Day invasion. Because he said, look, I don't want a bunch of Nazis pouring in on these rail lines to Normandy and stopping my invasion before it gets started. We have to have time to get a beachhead, and we have to have time to move out so we can take the initiative and sweep over into Germany. And if we're going to do that, we have to cripple this rail system. We have to stop it from operating. And so he goes to the military. Do they say to him, oh, no, John, that's too difficult. We can't do that. Do they say, oh, you can't block railroads, they just replace them. No. They said, all right, we get it. Hit the hubs. Pick the hubs out. Take them out. And by take them out, I don't just mean you bomb once. You go through one sortie or two sorties. I mean you go through until that whole hub is down, and then you keep it down. You go over there when Herr Speer, who is the armaments minister, is out there fixing it. You run over and strafe his people and kill them. And you keep doing everything you need to do to keep that out. That's the strategy. I said, oh, I did it. And he did it brilliantly. And I'll tell you how brilliantly he did it. There's one person, if any of you have read, and it's a wonderful book out there, the memoirs of Albert Speer, who was the armaments minister for Hitler. He acknowledges all these things about railroads, and Speer was very good about bragging about how good they were at fixing stuff. Every time the Allies did something, he ran it and he fixed it. Yeah, he fixed this, and he fixed that. And he was just really great about this. But this is what he says. In spite of the steady demands of the war, traffic continued to flow. In the future, he's talking about roughly 1942-43, or at least until the systematic air raids of the fall of 1944 once again throttled traffic and made transportation, this time for good, the greatest bottleneck in our war economy. That was Eisenhower's transportation plan. Eisenhower crushed what Speer was trying to do. Even Speer had to admit, you know, and Nazis don't readily admit when you got them. But he admitted it. And so that's the same strategy that could have been used. Let's look at some of these targets. Yes, ordinary tracks, problem. There's a hub. This is an example. It's kind of a bad picture, but this is period. This is definitely the time period we're dealing with. Look at the number of railroads. These are all trains in this railroad station, all tracks coming in here. Bomb this out. Take the whole thing out of here, devastating it. British was very good at that. Send 1,000 bombers over there, drop tons and tons and tons, hundreds of tons of bombs, and you take it out. Look at the bridges. There's a bridge. Set charges. Here. Knock it over like dominoes. That's a tough bridge to replace. That's an even tougher bridge. Look at that bridge. Look at what happened. We set charges here, or took it out, bombed it out. A lot of work is going to need to go into replace that bridge. And this one, I love. This is one of my favorites. Look at this. Bridge goes over water. That's always great. But then look at how it's supported. about 3.5 miles over here was the IG Farben SS Ward Industries plant. And Monowitz, or Auschwitz III, was a set of barracks for workers supporting that plant, working in that plant. That plant produced synthetic rubber and synthetic oil. They had a massive coal supply in the area of Auschwitz. And so it was good fuel to do those kinds of industries. And so they were doing a lot of this industry in here. But notice the rail lines coming in here. You've got rail lines coming in from Katowice, from Krakow. You've got rail lines coming in down here from Prague and Vienna. So it's crisscrossed with these rail lines. In addition, look at the river systems. You've got the Stola River here. You've got the Vistula River over here. Rivers mean bridges. And you've got bridges all over here. You've got a bridge passing the Vistula up there. You can't see them all from this map, but there are probably, on this map series, there are probably about 10 bridges going over water. Nice stuff to hit. Always make nice targets. And this is the way the camps are laid out. The reason I emphasize this is you notice the difference here. You've got this part of the enterprise here where the gassing is going is in one place about 3 or 4 miles away from anything else around there. So if you want to talk about minimizing casualties, you go there. You're still going to lose some people, but a lot fewer. And for good reason if you can take out what's going on there. So what happens? The U.S. minister in Switzerland says to the Secretary of State, Cordell Hull, on June 24, 1944, Hungarian Jews are being deported to Auschwitz at 12,000 a day. Now, if they're being deported at 12,000 a day, what does that mean? It means they're being exterminated at roughly that number. So they were way up by this time. You know, normally they average about 8,000. Now we're at 12. And so they're killing 12,000 Hungarian Jews every day. And the Secretary of State knows that on June 24, 1944. And this description from the minister included the exact railroad routes that were used across Slovakia. Slovakia is a very mountainous country. It's between Hungary, Budapest, and Auschwitz. And you crisscross that with railroads. They're all going over the mountains. What does that mean? Railroad bridges. Nice targets. Nice targets. And they're all laid out. They're all laid out in here. And so this was forwarded to the Secretary of Assistant McCoy, along with the statement that valuable sources of information say that bombing is the only way to slow down deportations. It's the only way. Okay, the World Refugee Board at the same time is making all these arguments. Destruction will slow down the extermination of Jews, might help escapes. The industrial targets, they were even trying to offer the Allies a bonus. They were saying, well, you know, there's a big industrial plant, IG Farben. You know, they're making stuff for the Nazi war effort. If you send some bombers over here and knock some stuff out here, you're going to get some benefit anyway, even in a military sense. You don't even have to do it to help Jews. If you don't want to help Jews, don't do it to help Jews. Do it just because you need it. And so they're making all these arguments. They're saying Jews might be killed in a bombing attack. That's true. But they would be massacred in any event. This argument has not been used to avoid these targets in the past. In other words, you've already been bombing in the area of Monowitz, in the area of the IG Farben plant. So you never really care about Jews. You can hit those Jews. And they did, by the way. There was one raid where they did hit some Jews over in that were just prisoners over in the barracks there. And so they didn't care about that. So I didn't care now. You know, the bottom line is this needs to be knocked out. You can say half a million people here if you knock this out. So, okay, these were the missions that were run to Auschwitz before the middle of 1944. Auschwitz was overflown by Allied aircraft in a mission to photograph IG Farben complex. 71 B-17s in June of 44 go on a bomb run, and they flew above the three railway lines to Auschwitz from Hungary. In July of 44, 452 bombers fly along the 5 deportation railway lines on their way to Bottom of Weckheimer Railway Line. So we were all over this place with bombers. All over it. So, camp bombings. The IG Farben Industrial Complex was bombed 4 times by British and American planes. The U.S. 455th Bomber Group bombed Monowitz, that was the IG Farben reasons they gave. We don't have bombers of sufficient range. I'm going to leave this to Alex to talk about. UK bombers would have had to go 2,000 miles over enemy territory. No, there were shorter ways to do it. Vital industrial targets are more important. We must win the war. Well, sure, we want to win the war at this point. You got the enemy on the run. You got, at this point, the D-Day invasion is taking place. You're posing an impression. You don't have a few planes to go off of a 1,000-mile sortie attack to do something. We might kill Jewish and other prisoners. You know, some of you have read, who's read Elie Wiesel's trilogy or Elie Wiesel's Night? I've got a passage here. I won't read it. But Elie Wiesel talks about what it was like to be a prisoner in one of these camps when you heard the Allied planes come over. And he says, and we got the same comments, Alex, at the conference from people who were there from Jerusalem that were in that camp, in the Auschwitz camp. They said, we wanted it bombed. Yes, we knew we could have been killed, but it was better than waiting for what we were waiting for and watching Jews after Jews after Jews going to the gas camp. You know, so, you know, again, a moral decision that had to be weighed, yeah, but at the end, not very good. We had bombing ranges of 2,000, 3,000 miles with U.S. planes. German city destruction, it's amazing. 4,000 buildings were destroyed in Dresden. 35,000 people were killed. The bombers hit the center of the city when all the war targets, the military targets were on the outskirts of the city. We hit the center, and we did it with 875 tons of high and incendiary explosive. Just turned that city into rubble. And for what? To kill civilians, basically. And I'm not sitting here to judge morally what we did. I mean, there are all kinds of people that write books about, oh, how horrible this was, and, you know, the war crime and all this kind of thing. I'm not so much in with that group. I just want to peel off a few of these bombers and send them over Auschwitz. Refuse to do it. So was this an important priority? How about Hamburg in 1943? 16,000 residential buildings, 42,000 people killed. Goebbels called this the greatest crisis of the war. Got plenty of bombers to do that, but we got no bombers to do Auschwitz. Here's the entrance of Auschwitz-Birkenau. Anybody know German? Arbeit macht frei. Work makes you free. Wonderful slogan for this camp. I got a couple of others. How about Arbeit macht Sklave? Work makes you a slave. How about Arbeit macht tot? Work makes you dead. That's really what's going on in this camp. So, okay, there's a picture of the camp in the winter. I just wanted to depict here what the various buildings look like. Those are barracks over there. But now, here's a diagram of the gas chambers. This is the way the gas chambers work. Gas chambers are over here. They have roof traps for the Zyklon B. Drop it in, you know, then it disperses in the air. Just does an incredible job of dispersion. The chemists got involved in that. Just an incredible job of dispersion. Kills people very quickly after they did some experiments where they killed them a lot more slowly. But so they take them here. They put them on carts, bodies, and they move them through the large hall here into, this is the crematorium area. They've got a high chimney here and a furnace room with all kinds of furnaces over here. They then do the ashes over here, take bodies, cremate them, create the ashes. And my friend Gretchen asked me, what did they do with the ashes? I did not know. I didn't have an answer to you that time, Gretchen, but I have an answer for you now. They had a swamp in near Auschwitz where they took these ashes and just dumped them. So they were filling the swamp while our current president was draining the swamp. That's what they did. This is how they work. But here's a diagram of the way the camp worked. But I want you to note this for bombing purposes. Look at where the gas chambers and crematory are located in relation to the prison barracks. Here is the dividing line here. The gas chambers are all on this side, which is the western side here of the camp. They're all west of this line. And all of these facilities are lined up in one area here. You have the guard main barracks and prisoner barracks all over here, different place in the camp. This depicts essentially the same thing. It's just a more recent photograph. And so what you've got here, if you look at this, here's your bombing target. 2017, cruise missiles off the ship, you can hit a dime with a cruise missile off the ship like that. Very accurate. Bombing World War II, not so much. As a matter of fact, they had a rule of thumb, if they hit within 5 miles of the target, we'll call that a score. We'll call that a hit. We'll chalk that off for the good team. You know, well, in reality, I mean, come on, we wouldn't tolerate, you know, that kind of tolerance. Today, we have more weapons, much better. But nonetheless, the prospect of going along this edge and wiping this out is a good prospect. Even the greatest military critics of this would say that most you would have lost a few hundred, maybe 1,000 prisoners if you got extremely bad luck here, but you'd be taking out those gas chambers, and the gas chambers are an expensive proposition to replace, and the Nazis didn't do gas chambers because they just were fond of gas chambers. They did it because it was the most efficient way to do what they were doing. Now, they didn't want to shoot people. They couldn't get volunteers. At some point, the military people, even the German military, would want to shoot Jews. And so they recognized that, and they had to get some other way of doing this. And this was it. And if you knock this out, particularly in 1944, how are they going to replace it? And how quickly?
sources in which you could find the range of the V-24 bomber. One is one that I have mentioned to these audiences before, and that's from a very authoritative source by Wesley Craven and James Kate, who are editors of the official United States Air Force History in World War II, which was published by University of Chicago Press, 1949 to 1955. And you can find these instances in volume 6 of
Well, let's give them another hand of applause. Stand up and speak as loudly as you can.
Marvelous presentation. Have you given this presentation to any of the BFW groups which still have some members from the Second World War?
Everybody interested in the question, has this presentation been ever given to BFW groups?
No. This is an Israel Matters exclusive.
Israel Matters exclusive. No. It hasn't.
I too want to say a fantastic presentation. Thrilled in the pastor of the church here. Thrilled at the turnout. Thank you for coming. It's fantastic. I'm sitting here thinking of Abraham Lincoln and the Emancipation Proclamation and how, with that proclamation, he turned the Civil War into a moral cause. And why? I'm just flabbergasted that, because this really is fake news, that I was thought why the Allies didn't get the word out, that why we fight, what we're doing here. And maybe you have some ideas about that. I don't know. It just seems kind of. Which is pretty easy to do.
You need to be at the microphone.
Well, you know, George, we need you. At least I do, because I'm hard of hearing. So I hear these questions.
Well, to repeat the question, as well as to reiterate the point that you made during the talk, which was it's almost unbelievable that this knowledge was known and that nothing was done about it. Is that?
But just, if anyone has an idea, why we wouldn't have said more about this? Because there was massive sympathy about this after the war. I can't imagine why there wouldn't have been during the war.
This way.
country in the world, if somebody commits a murder and is convicted of murder in the first degree, it's almost unheard of that he or she would get paroled after 10 years. Yet, in the 50s, the war crime criminals that were convicted after a trial were freed in roughly 10 years after their trials. All this happened during the Eisenhower administration. It takes two sides to let this happen. Germans maybe wanted it. The Americans let it happen. One that had place was a lot of anti-Semitism in the Eisenhower administration that really looked with a very cold-blooded blind eye towards the victims of the Holocaust and the letting these convicted murderers free after a very short prison sentence.
There was continuing anti-Semitism in the Eisenhower administration and also in the Adenauer administration in Germany, but that goes right up through the 60s. I mean, you had all of that was still going on as an undercurrent, but the rationalizations that were used were, we have to have the Germans united. We can't divide them. And they didn't like war crimes trials. There were many of these people who would identify with the accused in those cases and say, well, that was Hitler, that was Hitler's fault. So if you prosecute these people, all of a sudden you have a divided country, and you don't want a divided country because you've got the Soviet Union and all of its satellite states down. The Iron Curtain is sitting right in the middle, and we're scared to death that they break into Western Europe. It would be like we lost the Second World War, but the Soviets won it, and they're going to take over the rest of us. There was a tremendous amount of fear of that in Eisenhower, in his government. That was a pervasive thought, and that's what they used. They said, let's back off on this stuff. Why do we keep it? Isn't this old news? And of course, all these kinds of things, like you say, for murder, But you realize that there was only, I only know one life sentence. Alex can correct me if I'm wrong about this. I only know one life sentence that was actually served, and that was Rudolf Hess.
Yeah.
And the Soviets had him in Spandau. And yeah, he died in custody, no question about that. But there's all kinds of mystery that surrounds why they wanted to keep him forever. But everybody else, let him out.
Ezra was next.
Thank you guys for an incredible presentation, both of you. Alex and Tony, can you also expound a bit on the academicians who are apologists for everything that you've set up here? You continue to hear that.
Alex,
what did you talk about? Roosevelt was going for a third term. There was anti-Semitism in the country. He's a politician. The English needed to keep Jews out of the Middle East because they had to curry favor with the Arabs and oil they were looking ahead. So, not condoning, but the things that weigh on what the priorities are for politicians.
Ezra, there is absolutely no end to these stories, and many of them are absolutely bizarre, including the fact that there are many people who would be considered not only reputable, but even distinguished historians, who don't seem to know that there ever was a declaration of December 1742. And if you would like
ashamed that even in my own family, I see grandchildren, children who don't understand it, because luckily they grew up without the anti-Semitism. As Jewish, we could not join certain country clubs. We could not get into certain colleges. We couldn't go to certain public courses. It was there and it was accepted. And I'm glad the environment has changed, but the one thing that this lecture started with is you have to look backwards to look forwards. You cannot be off your guard. You must always be vigilant and try to remember that decent people do indecent things because of popular beliefs, and we must destroy those beliefs and accept that we are all one people. And good people are good people regardless of how they pray and how they practice.
With respect to that, there is a book by a lady recently, and was just ranting and raving. But in 1933, Ambassador Dodd sent messages to the State Department saying that a number of visitors who then subsequently checked with him at the American Embassy was telling him that Hitler is hell-bent on destroying the Jews and killing the Jews. That's what they were bringing the word. And of course, that corresponded to a lot of other things that he was saying along the way, which people, many people, just brushed off. But Ambassador Dodd absolutely did that.
Yes, I'm curious about the amount of pressure put upon our government and the press by any Jewish congregations throughout the United States. I've read a little bit here and there, and it just seemed like it was so subtle. There was so much perhaps fear, and I don't quite understand that.
You know, the complexity, the dynamic of Jewish groups and how they reacted and how they pressed the government is extremely complex, but I regret this whole area of study, because frankly, there's a pile of books like this about this subject, and it doesn't really amount to a heck of a lot, because the Allies knew exactly what was going on, and Jewish groups trying to put pressure. But, for example, Roosevelt didn't want to see the rabbis when they showed up.
Absolutely.
Winston Churchill didn't want to see Karski when he showed up.
And exactly.
There's constant refusal to deal with this, and Jewish groups were trying. I mean, there were some particularly articulate spokesmen, and some of the cables and things I've read, you couldn't lay out the arguments any better. And the Jewish organizations, they were in the right place at the right time, they were putting the right pressure on, but they were not getting any interest. Roosevelt was great for Jews at the time of the election. He was a supreme politician, one of the best we have ever had. And now I want to return to your question just a second, because I didn't have a thought about what you're saying. Why is there a State Department attitude? Well, the State Department people are trained, then and now, to believe in a kind of world culturalism. And this is, it's kind of anti-intellectual to some degree. In other words, they don't want to recognize accomplishment because they're so busy having to appease groups like Arabs or Nazis. It's an appeasement job. And so they're trained into a role where you just don't like Jews because Jews are scary. They accomplish things. They get things done. You know,
Let me answer Roosevelt's comments.
Sure.
As a boy growing up in Chicago in the 1930s, I remember the very strong mystique that Roosevelt had as an American Jew. My ward, my Jewish ward in the west side of Chicago, went for Roosevelt in two of his elections by 97%. When he died, my father cried. We didn't know this stuff.
Incidentally, to the previous lady, I just wanted to give you one particular date that Tony mentioned it, and that was October 6, 1943, long after all the declarations, long after Karski, 500 rabbis got on trains, went to Washington, D.C. to march to the White House and ask President Roosevelt's help. And President Roosevelt
pile of stuff, numbers all over the place between 5 and a little over 6 million, in that range. So different people are measuring it in different ways. Needless to say, the Nazis didn't keep track of this. You know, by the way, there were two things that you needed to have a successful death camp operation. The first thing you needed, and we could prove this in record after record after record, is secrecy. They didn't want anybody to know exactly what they were doing. And so they maintained secrecy. They even prosecuted members of the SS if they were blabbing about what was going on in the camps or what they were doing in the camps. They were very careful about that. But it is documented. It is documented. But the way it's documented is you have to make estimates. And this is why there's a million variation on this stuff. First of all, the Einsatz group, over on the Soviet side. Nobody was counting over there. But on the other hand, you kind of know what the populations were before that. You do some subtraction. There's complex mathematics, but the bottom line is 5 to 6 million is very well verified.
And one thing, of course, they did get very
well.
Yes, yes.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Say a few hundred thousand, certainly maybe even a million or more, could have been saved by immigration just getting out, because they were trying to get out and they couldn't get out. And that was the biggest single thing that could have been done. A combination of publicity and military action, you might have saved another couple hundred thousand. But these are large numbers. And to me, they're large numbers. Because we're talking about human lives. We're talking about wiping out people who are innocent of anything.
Paul, short question.
What was the Nazi response to the declaration? What was the declaration in 1942, you say?
Right.
What was the Nazi response to that?
They didn't respond.
They didn't respond at all?
No, they just ignored it.
However,
Paul, they didn't respond on the 17th of December, but it so happens that on the 13th of December, you will find an entry in the private diaries of Dr. Joseph Goebbels saying, "The British and the Americans," and I'm practically paraphrasing, "the British and the Americans are giving a lot of press exposure to the extermination of the Jews, but fundamentally I believe that they are happy that we are killing the Jewish riffraff." That is the quotation in Dr. Goebbels' memoirs. I think at page 241, actually.
Now, of course, again, remember, that's not publicized. That's something Goebbels thought. The Nazis skip over this stuff because it's never brought home. We never have a declaration like that, and then pound them with publicity so that they're forced to respond. They wait to see, just like they do now. The Missouri guys down.
Same bit.
I just want to say this: we're so short of time.
Okay.
If you do have a follow-up to that, ask it after the question.
Are you looking at me?
Yes, I am.
I just finished reading a book by a fellow by the name of Goldhaber, who wrote a book in the 90s, published in the 90s. And his question was, he could not understand when they undertook writing this book, and actually it came from a doctoral thesis, as to how the Holocaust could have occurred. And it's such a broad and complicated story that he blames the people of Germany for giving complete support. The Nazis themselves could not have carried out such a crime if it hadn't been for the attitude of the people in Germany, and which goes back so far, far beyond the beginning of the Nazi movement and Hitler's Mein Kampf in 1924, but we have to go back and further and further. And for instance, Martin Luther himself was a terrible anti-Semite. And so I would invite anyone who is concerned as to how the Holocaust could have occurred to see if they could get that book or possibly some other ones and find out how it was that the Holocaust occurred. So I'm kind of long-winded about this.
3 minutes ago.
Thank you for giving me a ear.
Yeah, well, at least you can learn here that there are some people, and I'm certainly foremost among them that have written about it, consider Daniel Goldhagen to be one of the biggest academic frauds ever. And the book is fraudulent in its fundamental assumptions and is lacking in the most essential ingredients of credibility, but it was very popular among lots of people. It sold millions of copies. It appealed to a certain sense among people which wanted to blame Germans, you know, as a sort of generic group. But Goldhagen did a terrible job. He, among other things, you know, he made assertions about, quote, German anti-Semitism, which he never compared with any other anti-Semitism. He simply claimed that German anti-Semitism was the worst anti-Semitism there ever was, without a word about Polish anti-Semitism, Romanian anti-Semitism, Bulgarian and Russian anti-Semitism. You know, for instance, Daniel Goldhagen never dealt with the question, where does the word pogrom come from? Is pogrom a German word? I don't think it's a German word. I think it's more a Russian word, actually. Where did the Chronicles of the Elders of Zion come from? Did that come from Germany? No, that came from Russia, actually. And so, there's a lot of stuff. I would suggest to you, you know, there was a very nice book called Hitler, the Nazis, and the Germans by a woman named Sarah Gordon, who published this book in 1984, Princeton University Press. And it's a very nice, responsible book which deals with the question of Germans, Nazis, Hitler, all of this sort of thing, in a very responsible way. And Sarah Gordon probably sold maybe 800 copies of her book, maybe 2,000 if she was lucky. And Goldhagen sold probably 6 million. But I will continue to insist that she was quite right in what she had to say, and sensible. And Goldhagen was not. Hitler's anti-Semitism far exceeded the anti-Semitism of members of the Nazi Party. You know, you might incidentally want to remember that Oskar Schindler was a member of the Nazi Party. He was the only member of the Nazi Party honored by the State of Israel. Well, there were probably a lot of people like Schindler. They were opportunists. They joined the party. They didn't know or care about what was going on. But Hitler was a man totally obsessed with the idea of the malevolent Jew, and he maintained that obsession from the day he wrote Mein Kampf to the day he died. And you might remember that on April 29th, the last full day of his life, he wrote his wonderful Last Testament, in which he blamed World War II on guess who? The Jews, of course, the Jews. He didn't blame it on physically handicapped or mentally handicapped. He didn't blame it on the gays or the gypsies. He blamed it on the Jews. The Jews were the quintessential enemy, and he was the essential spark plug of the Holocaust, the man who did it. Without him, I very much doubt that anything of that sort would have been done, and I would certainly absolutely not blame every German and all Germans, which may have appealed to a lot of people, but I think was very fallacious.
Well, with apologies to Julia and to Maureen, both of whom I promise we have exceeded the 10-minute limit already. So if you'd like to come back afterwards and ask your questions, that would be greatly appreciated. I'd like to say a couple of things. I wanted to make a comment about something that Tony briefly alluded to. You know, last year, Eli and I were haven't been to those horrible places, you should go. I mean, it really is a kind of life-changing experience to go there. But one thing that you alluded to was what happened to the ashes. Well, when we were there, we had a very extensive description. other concentration camps. It's something else to remember. So, thank you very much for your presentation. And before we stop, Tony and Alex both would like to say a few other words.
Yes, we have on a completely different subject. I don't know if any of you noticed this, but we had a promise of surprise today, and this is the surprise. We're going to make a presentation here to a member of this group that has been an immense source of friendship and support to many, many of us. And this is a special tribute to him. I could go on about his professional background for the next hour, and I'm sure you don't want that. But I look at other people in here. This is an extremely accomplished audience. There are all kinds of people here that have lots of professional accomplishments. But this particular gentleman has got some very distinguished things in that background. He was a medical advisor to the New Jersey Boxing Commission. He was a World War enthusiast, but a Vietnam War veteran, served in Vietnam as a medical officer. This man is an incredible physician. He's got a knowledge of medicine that crosses fields like nobody I've ever encountered. I mean, and if he for the friends in this group, and many of us have our own stories of this, I'm just going to tell mine. I had a daughter that had a tumor in her throat. I personally have some medical issues. And going to him, this man would spend days of research. If he didn't know something, and he knows a lot, and produce that to you, make it available to you, and give you the most incredible advice and friendship that you've ever had. And I don't know a better way to honor him. He's been a source of support to our committee in Israel Matters, and also a tremendous support to many of us personally. So we have an award to present. Medical advisor to Jersey Boxing Commission, and by the way, he did that to protect boxers and martial arts artists, and did some really path-breaking rules in that area. Cherished and celebrated physician, a friend of Israel, and our friend, do we need three guesses? Mark Malott.
I didn't even know
everybody help yourself to the refreshments, and thank you for coming.
It's pretty close to the bottom.